evening to all of you, and I once again welcome all of you to Mahanagar Gas Limited's Q3FY18 earnings conference call. I would again like to thank you all those who have connected with us today on our earnings call. As you all know, the CGD sector is growing and it's one of the growth sectors in India. Under the ambitious smart city mission, the government has set targets to launch a plan to replace LPG connections with PNG in urban identified areas, which will be developed as modern localities. In the coming years, implementation of CGD network will grow rapidly due to expansion of CGD in at least 100 new cities on account of increasing application of PNG in domestic, industrial and commercial sectors, along with CNG replacing other costly automotive fuels. Increased awareness in public at large and some commitments by the Government of India at international levels about environmental issues will also push the growth of the CGD sector further. As far as MGL is concerned, we are expanding our CGD network in the existing areas of operation. Currently, we have connected over 1 million households with piped natural gas. We are now operating 212 CNG stations, supplying CNG to more than 590,000 vehicles. We have now a steel and PE network of about 5,000 kilometers. Also, work is in advanced stages of completion for supply of gas to upcoming townships of reputed builders along the highways in Raigarh, and we have also connected a large number of customers in Uran in the Raigarh area. Work on gas supply to 6-7 major towns are also progressing through the virtual pipeline concept in the Raigarh area. In addition to one station which is already operational in Karjat, work is also going on to add another 3 stations in Raigarh during the current year. During the quarter, we have seen a growth of about 7.1% in overall sales volumes over the corresponding quarter in the previous year. CNG sales volume grew by 6.6%, domestic sales volume grew by 9.9%, commercial sector grew by 6.4%, and the industrial sector sales grew by 7.8%. Overall, the PNG volumes grew by 8.4%. The gross margin has also improved to 53.4% as compared to 51.5% in the corresponding quarter in the previous year. Improvement in the gross margin is mainly due to better price realization linked to alternate fuel prices in case of industrial sector, commercial customer category, and also a relatively favorable exchange rate. The operating EBITDA was higher by 20.2% at ₹200.89 crores as compared to ₹167.15 crores in the corresponding quarter in the previous year. EBITDA margin was 34.6% as compared to 33.1% in the corresponding quarter of the previous year. The net profit after tax grew by 25.2% from rupees 99 crores in the corresponding quarter of the previous year to rupees 123.99 crores in the current quarter. With this, I will conclude my initial remarks and I would like to open the floor for questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. Ladies and gentlemen, we will now begin with the question and answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may please press star, then 1 on their touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may press star, then 2. Participants are requested to use handsets while asking a question. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. To ask a question, please press star, then 1. We take the first question from the line of Kunal Shah from Enam Investment. Please go ahead. Mr. Shah, your line is unmuted. Please go ahead with the question. Mr. Shah, please respond. As there's no response, we take the next question from the line of Hirshit Sitwala from Matsya Capital. Please go ahead.
Hello.
Yes.
Yeah, I had a question regarding the capital expenditures. So you guided for around 250 to 300 crores in FY18 and FY19. I just wanted to understand what would the maintenance capex be after that?
The figure which we had indicated was inclusive of maintenance capex.
Okay.
It could be in the range of 10 to 15% of the total capex which we incur.
Okay, so maintenance capex would be 10 to 15%.
Yeah.
All right. My second question was regarding other expenses. So this quarter was higher as compared to the last quarter. So could you tell us a few reasons for that?
Historically, the OPEX is always higher in the second half as compared to first half.
Okay.
The primary reason for that is the most of the preventive maintenance activities and repairs activities are undertaken in post-monsoon season. Hence, you may find in Q3 as well as probably even Q4, OPEX could be a bit higher as compared to the Q1 and Q2 quarters.
Okay, sure. And one last question regarding the cash position as on date.
Cash position is quite comfortable. Right now, it is even higher than 31st March 17 position.
Okay.
So, it has strengthened further.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. We take the next question from the line of Abdul Karim from HDFC Securities. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thanks for taking my question and congrats for this set of numbers. See, company plans to expand its gas distribution network in current geography area like Greater Mumbai and surrounding regions like Mira Bhandra, Thane and Vasi Belapur. So could you update on the same?
So this year, we had set a target of about 150,000 new connectivities. We are pretty much on course in doing that. Next year, we want to increase the number of connectivities further. And our focus will be in Navi Mumbai, Raigad, and Thane district, etc., wherever our network gets expanded, we will have the opportunity of connecting newer households. So we are pretty much on course. On an average, we are doing about 150,000 numbers that we are talking about, and we can maybe even do more as we go along.
And second thing, there was some news in the media. The PNGRB has started to talk regarding the unified tariff for the country as a whole. So could you guide on the same, or is there any update on the same?
No, we have also read in the press that there is a move up for unified tariff. The only impact that it will have on us, it may increase our transmission costs marginally. And transmission cost is not more than maybe 8 or 10% of the entire commodity cost. So it will not have any major impact as far as we are concerned. However, the opportunity that we will get is to access gas from any import or domestic facility at a unified tariff. So it will put us in an advantageous situation of being able to get volumes from any supplier, from any source within the country or outside, which our belief is will bring our costs of procurement down much more than the marginal rise in the tariff that may happen because of unified tariffs.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. We take the next question from the line of Probal Sen from IDFC Securities. Please go ahead.
Good evening, sir. Thank you for the opportunity. Sir, apologize if you have answered this earlier. I believe I just got part of Ranade sir's explanation about the OPEX. But can you just confirm whether there was any one-off in the OPEX or this is just a normal increase that has happened in this quarter? That was the first question.
Basically, it's a normal, which is on account of preventive maintenance and repair. There could be some elements of provision with respect to certain contracts. But predominantly, it's a repairs and maintenance activities related expenditure.
So, sir, can we expect then, should we be building in a similar run rate then in Q4 as well, given that you're saying this kind of provisioning would continue?
Yes, similar trend can be expected in OPEX.
Okay. And, sir, the second question was with regard to the volume run rate, which has improved significantly in this quarter compared to the YY growth that we saw in the first half. What kind of trends are we seeing in Q4, sir?
So the trends are quite positive. As far as CNG are concerned, we are looking at increased number of vehicles getting converted on CNG. The run rate on PNG is also much higher because we are able to connect newer houses, newer flats, and also we have now focused on whatever housings were left out in the initially connected societies and areas. So the trend is quite positive this quarter, and going forward also we believe the same rate would continue.
So sir, FY19-20, looking at a 5-6% run rate is something that we should be working with as a guidance?
Yeah, that should be possible, yes.
Okay. Sir, one last question, if I may. If I calculate, and correct me if I'm wrong, if I just try and do a very rough cut calculation, the LNG cost that we would have paid comes to somewhere in the region of $8 to $8.5 for this quarter, which is a bit lower than what we have seen in, at least if you look at Asian benchmarks for Singapore spot LNG. Is there something I'm missing here in terms of, you know, what the cost is that we actually paid for our gas?
So I think it's compliments to our sourcing team. They have been able to do a better job than what's happening as a trend across the world.
So we are, I mean, can you, what you're saying is we have managed to source some sources of gas which are lower than sort of what the benchmarks would indicate this quarter, sir. That's what given us some margin.
I would tend to agree with what you are saying.
Okay, fair enough, sir. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you. We take the next question from the line of Chinmay Gandre from Future Generali. Please go ahead.
Sir, just one clarification on whether there is anything going to be on compulsory conversion of this aggregator cabs in Mumbai to CNG from diesel or petrol. Something of that sort had come up a year back, and maybe by this Feb end some material clarification was supposed to come up.
So there is no clarification which has come up as yet, but the economic compulsion is such that most of them, or rather all of them, are the newer ones which are coming up in Ola, Uber and aggregator category. They are getting converted onto CNG today.
So there is no mandatory requirement as of now?
The mandatory requirement is to use clean fuels. So of the clean fuels, CNG is the most economical and readily available.
So, but how would diesel fit into clean fuel?
No, diesel, see, the economics doesn't work out for diesel because they are talking of Euro 6, etc. I don't know when it comes. Then maybe it might be possible for it to be classified. But then, based on pure economics and operating cost, CNG is far superior. So therefore, people are looking at, you know, CNG, and the run rate of aggregators getting their vehicles converted is far higher than what it was there in the past.
So what is the current conversion rate? Sorry if I missed it. If you have mentioned it already.
We haven't given the numbers, but
yeah, for example, Q3, we have around 18,000 vehicles converted.
That's 6,000 almost. Probably.
Yeah, roughly 6,000.
Okay, thank you,
but
sir.
But current run rate is slightly higher than this.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Next question is from the line of Nitin Tiwari from Antique Limited. Please go ahead.
Hi, sir. Good evening. Thanks for taking my question. So can I have a brief breakup of your sales mix, the gas sales mix in terms of sourcing? So how much gas are we getting in terms of APM, then PMT and LNG midterm and spot?
See, as regards priority sector, which is mainly meant for domestic and CNG, for Q3, the mix was around 78%, which we have got from APM category.
Okay.
Around 12% will be from non-APM category.
Mm-hmm.
And rest is, of course, whatever industrial commercial requirement is there.
So that is LNG. So LNG, again, entire LNG sourcing is...
Yeah, entire industrial commercial, which is around 15% odd, it is to be through our LNG.
So, no, that is fine. I'm asking whether the LNG is completely on spot basis or there's a midterm contract that we have in LNG.
In this financial year, it has been predominantly RLNG, that is spot, I mean.
Predominantly spot, but there may have been a small term contract lesser than a year.
Achha. And sir, pardon a very naive question, but so when we are like, you know, talking about domestic APM and non-APM gas, so when we are looking at the pricing of that gas that we use as cost for our pricing of CNG and domestic PNG, so are we using a formula of 75% APM and 25% other than APM, or is it in the ratio of the mix in which we are getting the gas?
See, even the non-APM is priced same as the APM gas. So you have to take a call based on the numbers already given to you.
Mm-hmm.
And the price of APM and non-APM is the same.
No, you're not getting any gas priced as per PMT pricing?
No, there is some amount upper.
And philosophy for pricing is not cost plus basis. It is basically based on the prices of alternate fuels.
No, that is the selling price. I'm talking about in cost terms. So, like,
yeah.
So whether when you determine the cost of the gas which is going into CNG and domestic PNG, so is that pricing formula 75% APM gas pricing and 25% PMT pricing, or
it has improved towards APM. APM could be around 76% plus, and earlier PMT was around 25%. That percentage has slightly dropped.
Slightly dropped.
So maybe 77-23, something like that. You can take the combination.
Right, sir. Right, sir. Thank you so much for that, sir. And lastly, you mentioned that the current conversion rate of vehicles is about 6,000 per month. So what has been the number for 9 months? Like, you know, this for the last quarter, right? 6,000. So what is the 9 month number?
9 months. Number 37,000, 38,000 cars. You want a total number, correct?
Yeah, total number is also fine. So 9 month total conversion.
44,000 approximately.
34,000.
44. Yeah.
And sir, PNG connections?
PNG connections total number 60,000.
This is domestic.
Three quarters. Yeah, domestic only.
And
for three quarters put together, around 60,000.
And commercial addition, sir?
Commercial number actually don't matter much, but those were around 300 numbers in restaurant category.
Right, so for the 9 months again, right? Sir?
For 9 months, yes.
Sure, sir. Thank you so much for answering my questions.
Yeah.
Thank you. We take the next question from the line of Tarun Lakhotia from Kotak Securities. Please go ahead.
Sir, thanks for taking my question. I just have one, thing to understand from you. How do we go about, can you just help us understand the pricing policy? Your margins for the last 2 years have surprised on the positive side. Now that given that, crude is on a rising trajectory and domestic gas prices will always move up with a lag, should we start assuming that every year you would deliver a margin expansion in terms of a, per unit metric?
That's an interesting question. I think earlier also we had mentioned the financial year 2017-18 was definitely an exceptional one in the sense that there are a variety of factors on which margin is dependent. Almost in all respects, we had received positive indications. I mean, if you start off with exchange rate, for example, maybe in the previous year for 9 months, the exchange rate was around 67 rupees per dollar, whereas this time it is, say, 64 and a half approximately. That was one of the big factor we received the benefit on account of. Since oil prices went up compared to previous year, as a result, the prices of, let us say, industrial fuels like LSHS or FO had gone up. And as the alternative fuel prices went up based on our pricing philosophy, we could get better realizations in industrial category. Similar was the case in case of restaurant category. The alternate or competing fuel is 19 kg cylinders or commercial LPG. Those prices had gone up in the current financial year, which was to our benefit. I think earlier in one of the questions we talked about even the composition of the sources for our priority sector, that is domestic and CNG. Within APM and priority also, the share of APM moved little up further from July or August month onward this financial year. As you know, there is a difference between the price of APM and PMT.
Yes.
So that has also benefited us. Also, in respect of APM gas cost, on average basis for full 9 months, the APM gas was slightly lower, maybe around $2.61 per MMBTU, as compared to slightly higher figure in the previous financial year. So all these factors have been positive. RLNG, we have not, dollar MMBTU terms, we have not benefited much, but at the same time, the increase was also not much in spot RLNG, which we have purchased as compared to previous financial year. So literally everything has gone right, and as a result, we have seen the improvement in the margin. Now, the second part or the question which we have ultimately asked, what could be the future, or are we able to, whether we will be able to maintain similar things, improve further things, it will all be dependent on these factors. I mean, definitely APM gas cost, which is dependent upon the formula set by central government, that will be the primary factor. Exchange rate is also equally important. RLNG spot prices equally important. Alternate fuel prices are also important. And OPEX, I think we have reasonably managed well. That also was a favorable factor to us. I mean, there was an increase in OPEX, but which was mainly in line with the inflation. I think everybody accepts 7% plus as the inflationary trend. And at least on this 9 months to 9 months basis, if you see the OPEX increase, it is more or less in same region. So these are the different reasons why we have been able to put up good show on margin fronts.
Sir, end of the day, the prices are in anyways your hand, right? So even if these cost increases that you're talking about, you know, going forward, given that there is still a strong economic advantage of CNG or, you know, PNG as compared to other liquid fuels, you should be in a comfortable position to pass on these cost increases. So can we say that this 8 rupees per SCM of, you know, unit EBITDA, is that the base number to start with and assume some expansion on there, or should we just assume that at least that is something which you can sustainably earn?
I think the focus of the company is more on adding more and more customers, and which we attempt through offering value proposition to the customer. In the eventual process, not that we don't look at margin, but if you ask us the priority, we would more prefer to keep on adding the customers, because the low penetrations in domestic as well as in CNG if given a choice between volume game and pricing game, we will always prefer to add on more and more volumes. But at the same time, yes, you are right. We appreciate, I mean, the headroom available vis-a-vis discounts offered to alternate fuels. Yes, both in terms of domestic and CNG, we are comfortably placed. But this advantage we will probably use mainly for offsetting the gas cost increases, which we may see, and partly maybe to some extent in OPEX.
Understood. So on the volume growth side, this quarter, of course, have been better than the last few quarters. So, of course, this, you know, you have talked about that the vehicle additions have been better. Going forward, you know, earlier your guidance has been 6-8% kind of volume growth is sustainable. Are we still holding on to that? Is there a reason for you to revisit that?
I think we continue to hold 6% plus CAGR basis. That is what we will say, particularly with reference to business as normal. If some very strict implementation of pollution norms come up, or fuels like dirty cheap fuels like LSHS, FO, etc. are banned, then the opportunities are huge. But given the normal business without judiciary or regulatory interventions, I think 6% plus CAGR for 5-yearly basis, that is what one should assume for.
So thanks for this. If I may just add one quick last question.
Sorry. This is the operator.
Okay, I'll go, come back.
Thank you. We take the next question from the line of Sabri Hazarika from MK Global. Please go ahead.
Yeah, good afternoon, sir. Sir, I joined late, so I have a few bookkeeping questions also. First thing is that how many CNG outlets you had at the end of Q3?
212.
12. And what was the progress being made in Raigarh on both CNG as well as PNG front?
So CNG, one station is operational, three more in the offing. And PNG, I said we had added about 300 households in Uran, 6 to 7 other townships. Work is progressing, and we hope to, you know, connect them with piped gas, and then corresponding number of households will get increased as we go along.
Okay, sir. And second question is on your PNG, industrial commercial PNG breakup actually. What would be the breakup between the two?
It is volume breakup you want?
Yeah, volume breakup I wanted. Industrial versus commercial, in the industrial commercial category.
Okay, if you are talking about for Q3.
Yeah, for Q3.
Industrial was 0.213 MMSCMD.
Okay.
And commercial was
0.181. Right, sir. And if I may, sir, two more small questions I want. First is the 9-month capex of the company.
We have incurred little more than 150 crores.
Okay, so roughly it won't cross 200 crore for the full year, right, sir?
Maybe slightly higher also.
Okay, slightly higher than that.
Yeah.
And what would be your CNG sales in million kg?
One second.
Yeah, last time you said around 1.4 million kg per day was.
Yeah, I'll tell you. It is 1.410 mmkgd for Q3.
1.410. And what was it for Q3 FY17?
Q3 17 was 1.313. Yeah.
Okay, so fair enough. Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Thank you. We take the next question from the line of Saurabh Handa from Citi. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thank you for the opportunity. Sir, it's actually going back to an earlier question where you were just giving the split of your gas sourcing mix. Could you just repeat that? You said 78% is APM and 12% is non-APM?
See, on overall basis, 15% is for industrial, 15-16% is industrial commercial, which is fed through RLNG.
Okay.
And 85% will be for priority sector, which is consisting of APM, then PMT,
mm-hmm.
And now there is a category called non-APM, but which is meant for priority sector.
Okay, and so within that 85, yeah.
Breakup between PMT and APM, could be, I think, somewhere around 78% and 22%, something like that.
Okay. Okay, so this 78%, which is APM and non-APM, are both priced as per the formula of the government, right? Even the non-APM gets the same.
You are right.
Okay. So, and in terms of guidance for the next 1 or 2 years, you said you're maintaining a 5-year CAGR of around 6%. Is that what you said?
You are right. I mean, that has been the historical trend and which we hope to continue.
Okay, so around 6 to 7% is something.
And this is business as normal. That is
sure.
No judiciary interventions or, you know, any court directives. Without that, we are talking about.
Sure. So, and just my last question: the CGD, the PNGRB is talking about, you know, coming out with like 100 new licenses for bidding. So, what is your take on this? When do you think? What timelines are they looking at, and do you think it's realistic? It's something which you would be interested in, or these are just real targets?
So I think PNGRB is looking at coming out with the bidding for 100 new cities very soon. In fact, tomorrow itself they are having an open house on this very issue. So our expectation is next couple of weeks we should see maybe the first round of maybe 20, 30 or whatever number of cities they come out with being offered to various bidders. And we are looking at it very closely. We would look at, you know, bidding for a couple of them depending on how attractive they are or otherwise.
Okay, and here your competition will be everyone. I mean, now you would be competing even with the likes of like GAIL and the OMCs whom you typically partner with now.
Yeah. So we would be competing with everyone, but in certain areas we may have a strategic partner along with us. So depending on how it works out.
Okay, great. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. A reminder to the participants, to ask a question, please press star, then 1 on your telephone keypad. We take the next question from the line of Sabri Hazarika from MK Global. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thank you for the opportunity, sir. I have two questions. The first one is this non-APM category under priority sector. So this was not the case earlier. So this has been included for the whole CGD sector or it is only for MGL, considering that you have access
no,
to...
No, it has been offered to several other companies also. I don't know whether they are using it or not, but MGL has opted for it.
So right now the 110% would basically include non-APM also.
Right.
And what is the price of this gas, the same, base price?
Same base price as APM.
Okay, it's the same base price as APM.
Yeah.
Okay, sir. And second question is on this volume growth that you've given, guidance that you've given around 6%. So you said that it doesn't include factors like any kind of ban or some kind of like court mandates or something of that sort. But does it include that any kind of like new buses or something of that sort in the CNG category, something exceptional or some?
No, it's all business as usual. So if, for example, suddenly one transport authority wants 100 new buses, that would probably be an add-on.
Okay, and what about this Mumbai city taxi rules? Has it also been incorporated or it's not?
So whatever comes in as usual in terms of new taxis and new autos,
right,
that is factored in. But if there's a spurt or because of some other reason, sudden growth which comes in, that is not factored in.
Right, but 20,000-25,000 caps, rough cut estimate is still running on diesel. So have you accounted for one-time conversion of these or that is not included there?
No, we have given you the run rate of how many are getting converted.
Okay. Okay, fine. Okay, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you. A reminder to the participants, to ask a question, please press star, then 1. We take the next question from the line of Pratap Kedia, an individual investor. Please go ahead.
Thank you, Pratap.
Hello.
Hello.
Yeah, we can't hear you. Please be loud.
Hello.
Excuse me, this is the operator. Mr. Kedia, your voice is not clear. Can you come in a coverage area, please?
Oh. 1 second. Hello. Hello.
Yes, sir, you may go ahead.
Yes. So let me declaring such a steady state of numbers. One observation was that your increased by around 8%, but profit has not increased due to raw material cost. And raw material cost has increased as a percentage from 40% to 42% quarter on quarter basis.
Excuse me, this is the operator. Mr. Kedia, your voice is not clear. Can you come in a coverage area, please, and come back in the queue? We take the next question from the line of Bimal Sampath, an individual investor. Please go ahead.
Yeah, good evening. Just wanted to check that with these new cities coming up for bidding, will our balance sheet support it, or we'll have to look for additional funds and all that? I mean, how is the this thing situation? And second thing, I just understood, I'm not sure of this, that GAIL is also selling to industrial customers in Panvel, Raigad. Is it correct? Or
so, to answer your second question first, under the regulation, CGD companies are authorized to sell to any customer having requirement of 1 lakh or below. So any customer above 1 lakh will be directly connected to a transmission grid. And those would be the customers GAIL would be selling to. 50,000 and below, compulsorily all the customers have to go through the CGD network. So anything above that have the option of going either through CGD or directly. So there will be some customers in Panvel who may have a requirement of more than 1 lakh, which GAIL may be selling directly. Okay.
Right.
And as regards to your first question, balance sheet is pretty strong. It's a treasury surplus company. So any expansion activities we'll be able to take care of.
Okay. And one question which may again be naive, that we are established in Mumbai, the cost of acquisition of new customers, will it be much lower? And what is the cost, roughly, if we can tell, okay, what is the cost of acquisition of a single customer, you know?
It depends on each customer category.
Yeah.
And it is not possible to specify for a unit of acquisition, depending upon different geographies, what is the status of the different levels of pipeline and infrastructure, the cost will be dependent on that. When it's a question of basic infrastructure already laid and only marginal connectivity is to be done, that cost will be significantly different than customer acquisition to be done in a greenfield area.
Yeah, so now in Mumbai, I understand we have covered 1/3 of the potential customers. So next 2/3 cost of acquisition should be substantially lower?
Relatively lower it may be.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. Participants would like to ask questions, please press star, then 1. We take the next question from the line of Samrat Yadav, an individual investor. Please go ahead.
Thank you for the opportunity, sir. I just want to know, where do you see the company after 5 years? As you have already seen in the news that the government is focusing on the electric vehicles. So that is basically temporary, unviable for the business. So where do you see the company after 5 or 10 years? Like the target for the government is 2030.
We have actually already given you some kind of a foresight on how the company believes it can grow at around 6% CAGR over the next 5 years. And our belief is, if past is what can be looked at, we are quite confident we'll be able to do that. EVs are far away. There are lots of issues with EVs. And even if they come, CNG is one of the cleanest fuel available. So it will only displace other more polluting fuels in urban areas. Both EVs and CNG will find a big chunk of market share in the cities going forward.
Okay. Okay, sir. So one more question, sir. Like, do you see any impact of recently the government of Maharashtra has procured electric vehicles, electric buses for like BEST? So do you see any impact of these on the company?
No, we don't see any impact as far as volumes or sales are concerned. Maybe incremental buses, as many as they can hire, that much amount of incremental CNG we may not be able to sell to those electric buses. But otherwise, it's business as usual.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. We take the next question from the line of Vipul Patel, an individual investor. Please go ahead.
Good evening, sir. Continuation to the last conference call, you had mentioned that renewal for Bombay would be close to around 2020. Do you have a earliest date by when you can have a confirmation on that?
Only in the year when you know, we require a renewal, we will have to apply as per regulations, and we see no reason why we will not get a renewal.
Okay, fair enough. And the second question is, what is your target you know, year day to cover, you know, whatever license you have, Bombay, Raigarh, Navi Mumbai, those areas? I mean, like, when you think you will be covering 90% of this capacity, by what
so
year?
Our effort is to create an infrastructure to cover the entire market, you know. And, you know, once our infrastructure is in place, then with smaller marginal connectivity, we could access every customer. So it will, but the city is expanding, it's, as you know, towards Raigarh, new airport and smart city and whatnot, new industrial estates are coming up. So it's a continuous process. But our effort is to be able to reach any customer with a small extension of maybe 200-300 meters. That's what we are aiming at today.
Right, so the broad level infrastructure, do you have any timeline or a target to, you know, complete major part of it, say, like, let's say 80% of it? When you get the maximum potential, and from there you just have to go there 200-300 meters to the end customers.
So most of the city of Mumbai we've already covered. About half of Thane district we have already covered. The rest we are expanding on, but there's no timeline. You know, every year we have a roadmap, a work plan based on which how many kilometers we are intending to lay. That's what we do. But as I said, the city is expanding, so it's a evergreen expansion which is going to happen.
Okay. Thank you, sir. That's all.
Thank you. We take the next question from the line of Gokul Maheshwari from Mosaic Advisors. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thank you for taking my question. I just want to know the CapEx estimate for FY19. How much are you budgeting?
FY19, it could be 250 to 300 crores.
Okay. And sir, you mentioned about the volume growth from a five-year perspective that you could broadly be growing at 6%. This would, I assume, include the expansion into Raigarh?
Yes, it will be inclusive of Raigarh.
Okay, so I just wanted to reiterate, what is the five-year opportunity which you're looking at Raigarh on a per day MMSCD basis?
So initial potential we had said was 500,000 cubic meters, but that was based on the existing habitation, industrial industries and other things being there. But as we see now, the potential is going to be much higher because of newer announcements and newer investment happening in that area. We don't have any specific numbers today, but maybe as we go along, we should be able to give you those.
Okay. And in terms of this CapEx of 250-300 crores, what would be the split in terms of Raigarh and your core regions?
Raigarh, number one, it will depend on how many approvals we get in the Raigarh district. You know, entire CapEx is dependent upon the approvals given by local municipal authorities. But it could be in the region of, say, 50 crores to 75 crores.
Okay. And, I mean, just qualitatively, is like opening CNG stations in Bombay is difficult because of land constraints. Is it easier in Raigarh?
You could say it is relatively easier, but Not that we are not getting land in Mumbai. Half of the stations we are actually setting up in Mumbai area as of today, and the rest are outside.
Okay. Just lastly on the bus additions, while BEST as an undertaking has seen some depletion in its fleet, what is the broad sense which you are getting from the bus undertakings of Bombay as well as the other which operate in the city and its extended suburbs?
So you are right, the number of buses is not growing. The only buses that they are adding today is based on whatever grants they are getting. To that extent, the incremental volumes are actually getting added from private players and aggregators and autos, etc., which are more than offsetting the relatively lower growth as far as the STUs are concerned. Going forward, it will depend on the financial ability of these undertakings or how much financing they are able to get to buy new buses. But one thing is sure, it's not EVs in the next couple of years, because the cost of EV bus is maybe 3 or 4 times and the infrastructure is not available. So if at all they get the money, it'll all be for CNG buses.
Yes, sir. What would be the proportion for volumes from of buses from CNG in CNG?
This all entities put together, BEST, then there is an entity in Navi Mumbai and TMT in Thane, all those put together will be approximately 12% of the CNG volume.
Okay, sir. Okay, thank you so much and all the best, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you. Participants who would like to ask questions, please press star, then 1. We take the next question from the line of Pratap Kedia, an individual investor. Please go ahead.
Hello. Good evening. I was comparing the quarter-to-quarter results. The objection was that your sales has increased in amount terms by around 8.5%, whereas the profit has remained stagnant, and which was due to increase in the raw material cost as a percentage of turnover, which increased from 40% to more than 42%. So my query was, what outlook for raw material in the immediate future, whether it is going to see upward trend, or is there any scope of controlling the raw material cost?
There are two parts in raw material cost or gas supply which we are talking about. One is for priority sector, that is domestic and CNG. This gas is domestically produced gas. So the price for domestically produced gas will remain same for Q4 as regards in dollar per MMBTU terms, because it is based on a formula set by central government. The rupee implication for us will be dependent upon the exchange rate, whether it is favorable or not favorable. That will decide the total landed cost for us. Whereas as regards spot purchase we do of RLNG for our industrial and commercial customers, today there is seen some upward trend in the RLNG prices, which may continue for short term, but hopefully over medium term it should soften down.
And one more question, like just to offset the is there any planning to expand service area?
This is the operator. Mr. Kedia, your voice is breaking. Can you come in a coverage area, please?
Yes, I was asking, is there any extension plan for the company for expansion service area?
Excuse me, this is the operator. So your voice is not clear. May we request you to come back in the queue, please?
Okay.
Thank you. We take the next question from the line of Sunil Shah from Access Securities. Please go ahead.
Yes. Thanks, sir, for this opportunity. Sir, we have virtual monopoly in 3 districts, which is Mumbai, Thane, and Raigad. And our future growth engine will be driven from the Raigad district, which is very under-penetrated at this point in time. Sir, have we done any study on the density of population per kilometer type? Meaning Mumbai is clearly very, very densely or, very aggressively populated. So our cost will be absorbed with more and more number of customers in comparison with Thane. But how is Raigad in that on that calculation. Have we done any study on that grounds?
So you are right, relatively Raigarh has less density of population per kilometer, square kilometer area.
Right.
That's why we have taken a different approach towards Raigarh. It's mm-hmm. a low investment, high yield approach
mm-hmm.
where we have identified 6-7 different nodes where the trunk transmission lines are already there. From there, we will take tap-offs and make local distribution networks in the vicinity of those areas. So instead of an entire grid covering maybe Raigarh or northern part of Raigarh, we will have 6 or 7 nodes and concentrated distribution networks in the neighborhood, which will restrict the cost, and the acquisition cost per customer will also go down.
Okay. Fine, sir. That's really a great strategy. Thanks very much for throwing light on this. Thank you so much.
Thank you. We take the next question from the line of Siddharth Malhotra, an individual investor. Please go ahead.
Yes. Hi. Good evening, sir. My question was with regards to your dividend policy. Considering that you are sitting on higher cash reserves, like you mentioned, as compared to 2017, is there a possibility of higher dividends going forward?
See, the dividend policy is predominantly based on two principles. One is the sustainability and another is consistency. When it comes to sustainability, we would look forward to our future plans also. Now, you might be aware our regulator PNGRB has announced bidding for certain cities. So that will require certain amount of cash which will be taken into consideration. Whereas as regards consistency, you will find that we have been pretty consistent, particularly with reference to our rate of dividend vis-a-vis paid up capital. In fact, last year we declared 190%. In the earlier 3-4 years, we were at 175%.
Right.
So
right.
As and when the improvement is seen in profitability, our board of directors do take a call in that perspective.
Right. Okay. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, that was the last question. I would now like to hand the conference over to the management for closing comments.
So thank you very much for coming to this earnings conference call for Q3 MGL. And I would once again like to thank you all, those who are connected with us today. Thanks once again.
Thank you so much, sir, for taking time out for the conference.
You're welcome.
Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of Prabhudas Lilladher Private Limited, that concludes this conference. Thank you for joining us, and you may now disconnect your lines.